one ever said being sheriff was easy. Just ask the guys who ended up here. Not all of them died with their boots on, but some of them found themselves on the wrong end of union protests, prohibition, and even a moving train. We'll tell you more on this episode of Hidden Cemeteries of Washington County. Ken, we're here at the Old Scotch Church Cemetery north of Hillsboro. Isn't this where Joseph Meek is buried?
Yes. In fact, probably two of the more famous sheriffs in Washington County history are buried here. Joseph Meek, as many people know, is often called the father of Oregon.
He was in law enforcement?
He was in law enforcement because he was offered pretty much any position he wanted after the territory was formed, and the job he happened to want was sheriff. So, it's kind of hard not to talk about law enforcement without including Joseph Meek.
Yeah.
But he's not really why we're here today at the Old Scotch Church, because again, we have another one of the more famous sheriffs. You can't very well talk about Washington County sheriffs without including John Connell.
John Connell. John Connell's gravestone tells us nothing about his career. What can you tell us?
He had a fascinating career. He was first elected sheriff in 1904, and he served one term. And then he decided law enforcement maybe wasn't for him, and he became a very successful farmer and merchant in Hillsboro, owned a large department store in Hillsboro and that sort of thing. But 20 years later, the bug got him again.
Well, you know, that wasn't a very good resume for somebody who wants to be sheriff again.
Well, no, but he was very popular, he was very well known, very successful, and when he decided then again in 20 years after he left office, 1928, he decided maybe he wanted to be sheriff again after all.
Hmm.
And this time, he stuck around. And he stuck around through many of the toughest times in Washington County history. And he's perhaps best known, in fact, for during the Great Depression, there was a tremendous amount of labor strife in Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
And the governor at the time, Charles Martin, wanted the strikes to be broken in the mills, to keep the mills pumping out the lumber.
Hmm.
And the governor actually ordered the state sheriffs to use physical violence, if necessary, to break the strike.
Is that common?
Well, no, because most sheriffs said, no, I'm not gonna do that. But John Connell actually obliged, and at the Stimson Mill over near Gaston, which was at the time the biggest and newest and most modern mill in the state, and the real prize mill that they wanted to keep going, John Connell actually did form a posse that used physical violence to break up the strike, and he marched all the strikers to the jail in Forest Grove, about 6-8 miles away, at gunpoint.
I assume he didn't get in trouble for that.
No, he actually, with the governor, he was actually quite a hero. And that was in 1935, and he stayed in office, he kept getting elected. He had a serious heart attack at one point, but took a few weeks off, recovered, and went on being sheriff. And who knows how long he would have been sheriff, but in 1948, unfortunately, he suffered a stroke.
Mm-hmm.
And he said he would at least finish his term. But unfortunately, he died at home in Reidsville. And while he was still in office, but he died, you know, 44 years after he was first elected sheriff of Washington County. So when you think about law enforcement, he spans much of our county's history.
What a wild career.
He did. And we have a couple people with maybe even wilder careers that we're going to talk about at the Hillsboro Pioneer Cemetery.
Great. Let's go see it.
Thank you.
So we're here at the Hillsboro Pioneer Cemetery, and we're going to be looking at the gravestone of George Alexander. That gravestone really doesn't tell us very much about his life.
No, and there's not much to tell about his term as sheriff either, except the story of how he became sheriff in the first place, and then his life after he left his brief two-year term as sheriff. He came to power following in the footsteps of a man with a very famous name in Oregon history, a man by the name of Jesse Applegate.
So Jesse Applegate, is he the Jesse Applegate that did the Applegate Trail?
Almost. That was his grandfather. His grandfather, also Jesse Applegate, created a different route for the Oregon Trail that went cut down through California. And in fact, the first party along that trail happened to be called the Donner Party. We know that that didn't end well for that party. But the second party that came along actually included Tabitha Brown, who's noted as one of the founders of Pacific University. So good things came of the Applegate Trail. But his grandson, Jesse, ran for sheriff, moved up here to Washington County, became very prominent and ran for sheriff, and was almost a shoo-in to be elected. He was very popular, but he almost didn't make it.
Why?
Because on his way to a campaign event here in Hillsboro, his car was hit by a train.
Hit by a train?
Hit by a train. And he was nearly killed.
Wow.
But that didn't stop him. He stayed in the campaign and was elected sheriff.
Amazing.
So just about the time that Jesse Applegate became sheriff, Oregon became one of the first states in the Union to prohibit the sale of alcohol.
Oh.
And his job, obviously, was to enforce those laws.
Prohibition.
But not long after he became sheriff, and by the way, his sheriff career got off to a very promising start. He, among other things, he became the first lawman in Washington County to use fingerprints, for example, to solve crimes. But not long after he took office, the feds got a report of a large shipment of rum and whiskey down in San Francisco, where it was still legal at that time. But this train just happened to be headed for Hillsboro, Oregon.
Ooh, where it wasn't legal.
Where it wasn't legal. And so the feds got wind of this, and they tracked this train up from San Francisco, and just oddly enough, the train tracks essentially followed the old Applegate Trail, and the train ended up coming, rolling into Hillsboro in the middle of the night. I think it was about 3 o'clock, if I recall. And so the feds were laying in wait for someone to come and claim the shipment of rum and whiskey.
And who did?
Who shows up but the sheriff himself, Jesse Applegate.
You're kidding.
Nope. So that, of course, ended his law enforcement career.
Hit by a train twice.
Hit by a train twice. He went to jail. And George Alexander then actually was his chief deputy and took over for him. But George Alexander didn't particularly want to be sheriff. That wasn't his career goal. So he served out Applegate's term, but then he didn't run for re-election. But oddly enough, he did apparently keep the law enforcement bug a little bit. And in just a hint of irony, he after his term was over as sheriff, he was appointed as the chief prohibition officer for the state of Oregon.
A bit of irony.
A bit of irony. And he went on then from there to be the superintendent of the Oregon State Penitentiary in Salem for many, many years.
He got really serious.
So he got very serious, and he's, although his headstone doesn't reflect it, he really is one of the more important law enforcement officials in Oregon history.
Wow, what happened to Applegate?
Well, Applegate bounced back just fine too. After Applegate got out of jail, he was actually hired for a number of other government positions, and he ended up serving as clerk of the Oregon State Senate until he died many years later.
I guess crime paid.
You might say, in their case, it certainly didn't hurt, but we do have a much more tragic case in this same cemetery of someone we'll talk about, another sheriff who had quite a tragic end.
Well, let's go find out. Well, Ken, the last couple of grave markers we looked at didn't really tell us much, but what's the story here in this field?
Well, actually, those last couple of sheriffs we talked about were, in a sense, lucky to even have grave markers.
Uh-huh.
Because the man we're going to talk about now doesn't have one.
Wow, what happened?
Well, W.D. Bradford was a sheriff starting back around 1900, and when he took office, there had been quite a sensational murder just south of Cornelius that had been unsolved until he took office. But W.D. Bradford was apparently a pretty good sheriff because he solved the case.
And should bring him fame?
It should have brought him fame. The murderer was sentenced to hang. And as was the custom at the time, Bradford, as sheriff, attended the hanging in Washington County. And that didn't go well with W.D. Bradford.
Bothered him?
It bothered him very much, to the point that he could no longer remain sheriff. And in fact, when he left office, John Connell took office for the first time. But Bradford was never the same after that.
What happened?
Well, he apparently slowly went insane.
Because of the hanging?
That's the story. That's what his biographers tell us, that it just bothered him so much.
Wow.
That first he was unable to work and was sent to the county poor farm.
Oh.
And from there, he went insane and ended up at the state hospital in Salem and died without family or friends. And so he's buried somewhere in this field, which is actually full of potter's graves for people from the county poor farm and the state hospital. And that sort
wow,
of thing.
How tragic after his successful career to have to end up in an unmarked grave.
It's not a very good way to remember a sheriff who solved a sensational murder.
No. The men buried here probably expected a life of heroics and heartaches, but who knew the job would bring them everything from sweet revenge to insanity and disgrace. Thank you for joining us on this episode of Hidden Cemeteries of Washington County.